capable of great feats of strength and courage.
My grandmother told me that movies turned her dreams into something resembling stories. But the on-screen crushing of Black hope was institutional.
When I was a kid, we had Step and Fetch It, Willie Best, Buckwheat. But I still wanted to be them.
One decade answered the question, what happens to a dream deferred? Does it dry up like a raisin in the sun? Or does it explode? This is the story about a group of artists that changed the culture forever.
These movies were about us.
That's a nice change.
The music. The style.
Is that black enough for you?
The heroes.
You want the black guy with you, because he's going to help you get out.
When Billy Dee Williams came on, every woman in Hollywood hollered, ah!
I fell in love with myself. I said, my goodness gracious.
You see your role as a positive force or a negative one.
And when we made the film about the way things actually are.
All the artists, since I know them personally, are responsible people who are concerned about what is happening in the black community.
Movies is the stuff of fantasies. I needed a black cowboy.
First and foremost, I'm an artist.
You've got to walk in like it's yours.
They were proof that we were here, that we create culture, that we have voices, and that we will be heard.
I'm a black enough for you!
Elvis Mitchell, welcome to American Black Journal, and also welcome back to Detroit. You're in the Detroit area native. And it's always great to have folks come back and talk about their work.
Well, thank you for both welcomes. You know, yeah. It's a thrill to be doing this and a thrill to be Detroit native. Yeah. So thank you.
Yeah, we're gonna talk a little more about Detroit in a bit. But first, I do want to talk about the film festival. And your film, Is That Black Enough For You? This is one of my favorite subjects, by the way. Is black films, especially of the 1970s. I grew up during the 1970s, and I wasn't allowed to watch some of these movies when I was little, but I saw them later, and I got really into them because, you know, they're fun, and especially when I was like a young black kid, these were the first movies I experienced where you had black casts and black stories. And so it kind of frames the whole understanding of that for me. But tell me first, what inspires you to make this movie?
I think it's a similar experience to what you're describing.
Yeah.
And also you buttress that, I guess, the kinds of things we would see on television, you know, and those images, unlike now, didn't come with disclaimers or warnings or context. It's just, wow. And you watch and think, gee whiz, white people must be crazy if they think that's what we're like. And because I remember as a kid, you know, you watch these old movies, you think, so a white married couple sleep in separate beds.
That's wrong.
Okay, I don't know any white married people, so that's, huh, what? So all these things that were never really explicated, but left an impact anyway. So they had these films of the 1970s, which created a whole new mythology, I think, for not only for just people of color, but for the world. I mean, one of the points I make in the movie is just how pop culture was shifted by the way music was used in these films, and how that created a whole new appetite and new way to market movies that black filmmakers, and more importantly, black recording artists never got credits for, never got their due, you know. But is that always the story of the black experience?
Yes.
That's not getting our due?
Yes, it really is. So I want to talk about the sort of cultural challenge that this era and these films present. As you point out, you know, there are a lot of things about them that are troubling in terms of the way that they portray African-American life, and the way television, of course, was doing it. But they do really importantly capture parts of the culture that were accurate and that kids like me could kind of relate to. And just as important, they paved the way for the Black film that comes in the 90s and after, when we really start to come into our own and start to tell our own stories in a way that is really authentic. I want to talk about that tension, I guess, between being uncomfortable with some of these films, but also appreciating them.
Well, I think that tension you're talking about was extant even during that period, because while you had Black action films, you also had Sounder, which was the first film to have a nominations for the actor and actors, African-Americans. That had never happened before that moment. Mm-hmm. 1972 is also a pretty incredible year, because you also have the nomination of Diana Ross, The Lady Sings the Blues. That's the first time a Black woman is nominated for Best Original Screenplay. Suzanne DePass, The Lady Sings the Blues. That still hasn't happened since. And the following year, you have Claudine, which is a project that the late Diana Sinis was developing for herself. And when she got too sick, wasn't able to do it, she passed the baton on to her dear friend, Diane Carroll, who got to make that movie and got an Oscar nomination and got a chance to respond to this image of her that existed in this TV show called Julia just 5 years earlier.
Well.
And to put her feet on the ground and show this earthly presence that she hadn't really got a chance to demonstrate in mass media before. You've got Sparkle, which has given us enduring songs that are still part of the world.
Mm-hmm.
You've got, my gosh, what I think is one of the crowning achievements of American cinema, and that's, you know, Killer of Sheep by Charles Burnett. Mm-hmm. There are extraordinary films that came out of that period that make it a much more complex time than it's given credit for to do. And that's why I've been very specific about saying, even though people seem to miss the point somehow, that this is not a film about Blaxploitation.
Right.
This is a film about the breadth and expanse of films that were being offered. You've got the movie done by Bill Greaves, William Greaves, Symbiopsychotaxiplasm, Take One. Without that, you've got no Eric Andre. You've got no Sacha Baron Cohen. There's so much experimentation in formal terms being done. And also, you've got movies that I think set the tone for what Black action films were, but bigger than that. You got Sweet Sweetback, which is something that comments on Black imagery, that plays with the idea of the way we respond to Black imagery. And you know, it's interesting, too, that so many of these films, in addition to being enormously impactful on the African-American community, were huge popular successes, and they don't get their due for that either.
Connect the dots between that era and this era. And the eras in between. What are we to make of what comes out of the Black films of the 70s that you know we enjoy today?
Gee whiz, you know, I can't help but watch Michelle Yeoh win for Everything Everywhere All at Once and think about the action film she did in the 90s and think, you know, without the example of Pam Grier, does that
mm-hmm.
exist?
Mm-hmm.
Certainly, 5 years after Coffee, there's Charlie's Angels on television, which then becomes a huge movie. And that changed the culture. There are so many of these moments that, in these films, I think, were set seismic impact on the way the world worked. And I think the world of hip-hop doesn't exist without the example of what Curtis Mayfield was doing. When you hear Chuck D talk about Public Enemy being, you know, like Black CNN, well, Curtis Mayfield was doing that and influenced Marvin Gaye, who then probably influenced a bunch of other people. So... We could go on. That was the problem with making this documentary, is that it could have been 10 hours long and just trying to cull stuff. But also, it's one of the fun things for me, and I hope you got this from the two, is seeing in a lot of these cases the thrill that Black actors got from working with other Black actors because they had been so isolated. And I think we're about old enough to remember that when you saw a Black and white person on TV in a movie, that was adult entertainment. So, what? Because they're talking. It's adult entertainment? That's, huh? What?
Yeah.
Like, it was really a huge and terrifying thing. So the way the walls have come down, I think, is that we don't look askance at the idea of a white person and a person of color being on screen. In fact, it's on the CNN every morning now, and just everywhere else, the CBS. So those things have changed too. But the way I think I think they've changed movies is that there's always been an entrepreneurial aspect to Black cinema.
Yeah.
And we look at Melvin Van Peebles to Spike Lee to Robert Townsend. These have been people and filmmakers who changed the independent film movement who are still, their practices are still being employed today to get movies made. You know, I was just interviewing Robert Townsend last year. I called him up because I knew it was the 35th anniversary of Hollywood Shuffle, which the movie he made with his credit cards. Uh-huh. And I just thought, well, gee, I want to hurry up and get to this before somebody else does. And I just thought, nobody's going to do this. Let's not get us.
No one's thinking about it, right?
No. They'll do something, the 20th anniversary of the OC.
Yeah.
But they won't deal with this. And they're filmmakers who are still using credit cards to get films made. And he changed the narrative. And also because, and this goes back to, Bingo Long, the All-Stars, and the Negro Leagues, the fact that the Negro Leagues, they had to build an audience, bring that audience literally with them to the stadium, sell snacks to that audience, get the audience to engage with the team. So in addition to everything else, they had to play 9 innings of baseball.
Yeah.
So for Oscar Michaud or Melvin Van Peebles or even Ava DuVernay, you got to find the money for the movie. You got to make the movie. You have to market the movie. I mean, that's a rarity.
Yeah.
And it still exists. You asked me to connect the dots. That through line, that A to B, is still an issue for filmmakers of color.
Yeah. So I do want to talk a little about Detroit. Of course, you're coming here for the hairing of Is That Black Enough for You? And it's a return home. You were born in Highland Park. You went to Wayne State. And you have a new role at Wayne State. I love that. I love that idea of returning home to pursue your craft. Talk about that narrative.
Well, that's pretty great too, because I've been lucky enough to teach at a few places. I've taught at Harvard. I've taught the American Film Institute here in Los Angeles. I taught UNLV at its film program. I've spoken at universities around the world. So it's pretty awe-inspiring. It knocks me off my feet to be invited back to my alma mater, to be able to tell people how important it was for me to be here. When I was in school, I was I managed and was a projectionist back when we used to have such things at a movie theater in downtown Detroit. And so in the early 80s, I was doing that and putting myself through school. And so just to get a chance to talk to the student body at Wayne about the way that place, the way growing up in Detroit formed me. I don't want people to think that. In fact, I'm so much a Detroiter that wherever I go around the world, my watch is always set on Eastern Standard Time. I was just in Rotterdam for the Rotterdam Film Festival, and people, is your watch broken? No, that's Eastern Standard Time. Where are you from? I'm from Detroit. Was that on Central Time? No, it's not on Central Time. So yes, but anyway, that's how foundational Detroit is to me and my sensibilities. So I'm beyond honored to be asked to come back and teach a course there, and I hope there's more of that in my future.
Yeah, no, we do too. It's really special. All right, Elvis Mitchell, looking forward.
Before you go, I want to say how much the tradition of Black Journal has meant to me. Growing up in Detroit. I just want to say the reason I fought to make time for this, and I'm glad you're able to be flexible in your schedule too, and you know the same way I do how important this show is, and that it's still, the standard is built, still being kept aloft and alight, is really important, I hope, for generations of people of color to come.
Yeah, we're working on it. We're working hard at preserving what they built here for us. Great to talk with you, and we look forward to you being at the film festival.
Thank you so much. I'm looking forward to it too. Thanks again for your time.